I guess it's time for another lesson in family values. Hey guys, DP right here, and today I am continuing with the what if I started a few days in continuation of Gine week, and I was quite surprised to seeing this take off the way it has. Not exactly a high view count, but the discussion it seemed to have formed and how it's I think it seemed to have drawn more people in, and that is, what if Gine was raised by King Cold? And this was definitely an interesting story, definitely full of divergencies, and well, it basically led to a little urchin of a Saiyan, Gine, the mother of Goku, basically scrounging around, looking for food, basically struggling to survive after pretty much being abandoned by her parents for basically her being so weak and them not really being able to advance further in the Saiyan ranks because, well, looking after Gine. In a way, it was sort of a kindness and whatnot because Gine became quite independent because of that. However, she got curious at all these new space pods and devices that have been around lately, ever since, you know, King Cold took over the Empire. And so she decided she wanted to more or less check it out, and this is where she ran into the into King Cold himself, who basically decided to more or less adopt the young girl and raise her as her own. After all, your own personal Saiyan could be very useful in the long run, especially when we look at, you know, keeping the relations up. So King Cold ignored his first instinct to destroy Gine on the spot and chose to raise her as his own daughter. And well, this led to Gine forming a friendship with his son Kula, and they pretty much got along pretty well, and always playing jokes with each other and things like that. After all, Kula was told to treat Gine like family, so he's gonna do what his father says. At least right up until later years in their adult life, where King Cold decided that Kula was too much like him and decided to have him decommissioned. And well, with Gine being sort of the bridge between the Saiyan world and Empire, she has played quite a bit of a role in keeping the Saiyans efficient, and her taking a liking to Bardock and his squad and what they've accomplished, pretty much she's promoted them ahead of time, and occasionally she goes on missions with them, and you know, they conquer worlds easier. This does make Gine and Bardock bond, which considering that Gine doesn't shy away from conquering planets and killing if she absolutely has to, and battle, she's still very much still the kind, caring Saiyan that we know and love from the original, except that just basically when it comes to impressing her adopted father, you know, so he doesn't like change her mind and destroy her or anything like that, she's still got to put on the Queen of the Universe sort of act. Well, with Kula decommissioned and now Frieza running around, it's become sort of Gine's duty in between going out on missions with Bardock and her and his crew and maintaining relations between the Saiyans and King Cold's empire. It's sort of been her other mission to help Berry Blue and Kikino with raising Frieza. However, Frieza still pretty much does what Frieza wants to do, and he of course doesn't shy away from killing his own servants when they disappoint him. Be careful, Gine. You may be my big sister and all, but I will not hesitate to kill you if you make me too angry. And well, needless to say, Gine's relationship with Frieza is not a very good one. Gine does not like this new offspring of King Cold. Kula was definitely the better and more wiser choice to succeed him in his empire than giving it to to Fraser, this complete, crazy, sociopathic madman or mad alien. you get the point. And well, since as time has gone by, Bardock and Gine have indeed had a coupling, Bardock and Gine getting along. It just surprised Bardock that Gine has this kind, loving nature, as well can be pretty ruthless on the battlefield. And well, Bardock kind of likes his her caring nature. Whenever other members of the crew or even Bardock are too badly hurt, you know, Gine always carried a bottle of the same sort of liquid they use in their healing chambers. So she's always happy to give them band-aids and things like that. And whenever Gine would go back to her homeworld, she's always giving money to the other little kids who were like her at that age, who were more or less too weak, considered too weak and abandoned by their parents. And well, this actually made Gine very popular among the Saiyans. Unlike Vegeta, who is, well, we all know about the cruelty of King Vegeta that we've all heard about and seen in the stories. And well, one day Gine is really laying down the law on King Vegeta, questioning about these two mysterious unauthorized departures that no one cleared through her. I'm talking about the removal of Broly and Paragus going after his son Broly, him being vanished to Vampa. Vegeta is not saying a word. He's denying that this had ever happened, and if it did, it was done completely without his authorization. King Vegeta lying through his teeth. Of course, Gine can see right through this, but, you know, there's just no way she can actually prove it. And well, the rumors go around, and you know, them talking about what happened to Paragus and his son, the rumors pretty much inform Gine of what's actually happened, and she's more inclined to believe these rumors. After all, she's all too familiar with Vegeta the Third's cruelty anyway. And well, so like I said, Bardock and Gine did form their relationship like they do in the original, in different circumstances. Gine not really being resolving her life as a cook. Mind you, she can still cook. She's always happy to treat Bardock to a nice family meal anyway. With that, Bardock and Gine do have their first Saiyan child, Raditz. Now, unlike, and of course, 5 years later, or when we catch up to the events of Dragon Ball Minus, Kakarot will be born as well. Now, the difference between Raditz and most likely Kakarot, when we get to Kakarot, is that their powers are going to be significantly different to what they are originally. Just being how Gine is a lot stronger. She's on par with Cooler and Frieza. That's how powerful Gine actually is. King Cold would not have it any other way. Even an adopted member of a family must be powerful and be able to rule and show signs of leadership and all that stuff that King Cold admires. And well, thanks to Raditz being bored, the adopted nephew of Frieza. Yes. Grandpa King Cold? Come on, even you gotta admit that's funny. Well, Raditz has a pretty high power level. His latent potential is about on par with Prince Vegeta the Fourth. And well, this actually leads to Raditz and Vegeta and Nappa's relationship being significantly different than what it is in the original. Raditz being formerly well respected. After all, he is the daughter of Princess Gine, the adopted daughter of King Cold. You gotta show him some respect. Because technically, Raditz outranks even Prince Vegeta. Raditz, in a way, is a prince of the Frieza Empire. That outranks King Vegeta. And so, with Nappa and Prince Raditz and Prince Vegeta. It's, yeah, more fun for them. And if anything, Nappa's the one who's made fun of for being the weakest. And with this, it actually means Raditz and Vegeta actually get along during their time together. And, well, just like how Gine raised Raditz originally, Raditz is still one of the cautious nature and does use his brain and tactics when he goes in a battle. So, needless to say, his squad with Vegeta and Nappa have a pretty high success rate, even though Vegeta and Raditz are still just children. Even Frieza can't help but be impressed by that. However, it doesn't mean he likes that, you know. Gine being as powerful as she is, Raditz with the kind of potential he's got, not to mention this Bardock. Yeah, Frieza is not really liking this one little bit, and we have now crossed into the timeline where King Cold officially retires and hands over his empire to Frieza, just like he does in Dragon Ball Minus. Handing over the reins to Frieza. Well, not Dragon Ball Minus, sorry, the Dragon Ball Super Broly movie, how he hands over his reins, and they present the Saiyans with their new Scouter models. And well, things more or less go pretty smoothly for the next 5 years, and since then, Kakarot has now been born too, still in his nursing capsule. And well, his latent potential isn't as high as his older brother's. It's about half of that, but still pretty darn good considering. And well, he's more or less in the nursing capsule on the Saiyan world in Bardock and Gine's Saiyan home. And well, one day, this is where things begin to go very different and very bad. Well, one day, Gine was aboard, well, not really aboard Frieza's ship. He was on Frieza's homeworld, Frieza Bay 719, whatever it's called. You know, the one we mainly see Frieza at. So Gine was sort of popping in there to report what's been going on with the Saiyans lately. However, just when he approaches Frieza's chambers, she hears another voice talking to Frieza, someone sounding very demanding. It's very distinct, if not scary kind of voice. You're lucky, Frieza, that your food is actually pretty good. Otherwise, I'd have you destroyed on the spot, you upstart. Now about those barbarians, the Saiyans. I would like you to get rid of them for me. And, Frieza is hardly agreeing with this, and this surprises Gine. And she does manage to sort of peek through the door a little bit, and sees this purple cat-looking guy just sort of staring down Frieza, and Frieza looking slightly intimidated. The first time Gine has seen Frieza like this. And, also, there's this taller blue gentleman standing with this purple cat, and well, Gine can just manages to overhear the words, "Of course, Lord Beerus the Destroyer, I will take care of those monkeys for you, no problem." And with that, pretty much Beerus takes his leave, ready to take his nap, and Gine is horrified by this. Soon as he's left, she charges straight into his chamber. "You're not serious, are you, Frieza? You really intend to wipe out the Saiyan race? Who was that guy anyway?" And well, Frieza more or less warns Gine of her insolent tongue. Just because you're a member of the family, Gine, don't think I won't destroy you like every other Saiyan. And if you must know, that was Beerus the Destroyer God of our universe. If we don't do what he says, he will destroy us all. The entire empire, father, you, me, Cooler, you name them. They're gone. So you're only obeying him out of fear? It's not only, and well, this is where Frieza pipes up and mentions the legend of the Super Saiyan that he intended to wipe out the Saiyans anyway. You can't just massacre the entire Saiyan race like this. What about all the Saiyans have done for you, especially under my leadership? They're more loyal now than what they ever have been, the planets they are conquering. You are wasting Saiyan warrior potential. If we all unify the Saiyan race, I guarantee we could take out that destroyer god or whatever. Why don't you send me back and just allow me to convince King Vegeta to completely unify the race? Become strong as one. And well, Frieza's not liking this insolence that Gine is showing, nor does he really like this plan one little bit either. After all, there's still the chance the Saiyan race more or less could oppose Frieza and just take him out someday. Especially if they do what Gine is suggesting, let the Saiyans become stronger. However, Frieza pretends to go along. You know what, Gine, you're absolutely right. Why don't you go back there and convince King Vegeta for me? And well, with that, Gine just says, thank you, Your Excellency. I won't let you down. And well, this is where Gine is basically racing off to Planet Vegeta as fast as she can, as fast as her little Saiyan pod can carry her. And well, with that, she lands, and as a precaution, she tells Bardock what's going on, and that it's probably in their best interest that they get Kakarot off-world. And in which case, they do so. And well, Gine, of course, promising, Kakarot, don't worry, if I'm wrong about all of this, if nothing happens, we will come for you. Just don't forget about us, okay? And, you know, the departure of Kakarot's about as heartwarming as it is in the Dragon Ball Super Broly movie or Dragon Ball Minus. And, well, with that, Gine comes before King Vegeta immediately and tries to convince him of what's happening here. Tells him all about how this creature Lord Beerus is, has ordered Frieza to destroy the Saiyan race if they don't come to terms and unify. And well, King Vegeta's like, you really expect me to believe such a story? Even though he's heard of Lord Beerus before, Vegeta just thinks this whole thing is a ploy to just get them to work harder for Frieza and do more things for Frieza, even though they're pretty much doing everything they can at the moment. I ought to have you arrested and executed for such remarks. And well, King Vegeta is not budging or listening whatsoever, and this basically leaves Gine no choice but to challenge King Vegeta for ascension to the throne. A battle of ascension. The last time this has happened is since King Vegeta the First took over as king, overthrowing the previous Saiyan family. And well, this leads to an all-out battle between King Vegeta and Gine, and well, needless to say, King Vegeta cannot do much against this at all, Gine just being way too superior in strength. Like I said, she's on par with Frieza. And well, with that, King Vegeta is more or less killed or slain. Now, Gine did not want to kill King Vegeta, but King Vegeta was too stubborn than to stop this foolishness that, yeah, Gine put a little too much power in one of her attacks and ended up killing King Vegeta. But with the battle done, Gine has won the right to ascend to the Saiyan throne, officially now becoming the Queen of all Saiyans. And well, she has convinced everyone to swear all fealty and loyalty to Lord Frieza, and that from now on the Saiyans have to unify and get stronger, so maybe they can counteract and battle Beerus when he eventually wakes from his slumber. And well, Needless to say, Frieza has no intention of keeping his word, because now his ship has arrived, and Gine can sense this, and Gine is pretty much caught on to what's going on right now. Frieza, double-crossing bastard! And well, with that, Gine has more or less, with her husband Bardock by her side, has pretty much ordered every Saiyan to quickly assemble towards the palace, just as many of them as they can. And well, with Gine's scouter, she can tell that this army that Frieza has brought with him, and Frieza himself, is preparing for battle. She can see that Frieza is charging up a big death bolt to eradicate all the Saiyans, even killing his own adopted sister Gine. And well, this is where Gine more or less draws the line. And well, Gine orders Bardock to power up a energy ball. You know, a trick that she's seen Bardock do before in the past in their battles, where they all transform into great apes and wipe out planets and civilizations. He orders them to do the same thing here, and Gine, with a powerful roar, orders everyone to look up. Every single Saiyan on the planet is transforming into great apes. And with a 10 time multiplier with Gine's power, this is cool. This is like stupidly more powerful. With the Frieza's death ball racing towards them, they all fire a combined energy beam together, and this sends the blast hurtling back towards Frieza, who is more or less taken out by the blast along with his ship. And just like that, the Saiyans are more or less free from Frieza. However, King Cold is getting word of this, and King Cold's sort of caught on immediately that Gine obviously had a hand in this. There's no way Saiyans could generate that kind of power, at least so he thought, that it would overthrow his son so easily. Mind you, yes, the Saiyans actually could gather up that strength on their own. After all, every single Saiyan was a great ape. That's definitely enough power to push back Frieza's blast, considering they were just lucky that Gine saw the attack coming when she did. And well, with that, I think that's actually where we'll leave things for right now. So what do you guys think? Actually, I'll leave you with a little something else. With the aftermath of the attack, and Gine obviously seeing that King Cold's going to be coming here asking questions, and well, if Gine can avoid any more killing and bloodshed, even destroying King Cold, she's going to try. So this is where she actually sends Kikino and Barry Blue, who were fortunate enough to be more or less on the planet, sort of watching. They were sort of more or less babysitting Kakarot at the time. After all, they are considered members of Frieza's family. They've got to learn all this stuff about the planets and everything too, so it did fall on their duties to watch them and look after them. And Frieza definitely didn't have King Cold say so to blow up the planet. So Gine has given Barry Blue and Kikino an important job to go out into the cosmos, to the planet where King Cold has banished Cooler, and reawaken her long-lost sibling. And that is where we're going to be leaving things for right now. So what do you guys think? Did you enjoy this story? Did you enjoy the character development with Gine? How she ultimately became the savior of a race and is now the queen of all Saiyans? And well, sorry Prince Vegeta, you just lost your ranking. And yeah, what other complications is this change in the scenario gonna give us, you know, with this whole new story that's taken place and developing? All this and more next time. Catch us later. See you next time. And don't forget to like and subscribe and hit that little bell icon for more what ifs. See you next time.